My name's Lon Moeller. I'm the Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs and Provost. It's my honor to welcome you to tonight's Presidential Speaker Series event with Mr. Tyler Grinnell, Vice President of Flight and Launch for Virgin Orbit. I'd like to first make a special welcome to President Butler, the members of President's Core Leadership Team are with us tonight, Mr. Jeffrey Trauberman from Vox Space, General Ernie Audino and Nick Burnett from Congressman Michael Waltz's office as well. And we're very honored tonight to also have Congressman Waltz with us as well for this event. Congressman Waltz represents Florida's 6th Congressional District, which includes Volusia County. He's a native of Florida, graduated from the Virginia Military Institute, served over 24 years in the United States Army, is a colonel in the National Guard, a combat-decorated Green Beret, the first Green Beret in Congress, I think you said today, and hopefully one of the first Green Berets in space. We talked about that as well. A former White House and Pentagon policy advisor, a small business owner, and a very proud father. Congressman Waltz has been a very strong supporter of Embry-Riddle. Congressman, we appreciate that support, certainly. And we also appreciate his efforts in emphasizing the role STEM education plays and keeping the United States on the cutting edge of both innovation and technology. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Waltz to kick off this evening's presidential speaker event.
About 10 minutes. Is that good, Dr. Butler? Because I can go on. I want to leave some time for Tyler. I'm a full-blown space nerd and really excited that this came together. I am one of three members of Congress out of 435 of us that are on both the Space Committee and the Armed Services Committee. So what that means is we have oversight and develop the authorization, which means the policies, what they can and can't do, and the appropriations for NASA, for NOAA, basically they do all our weather satellites. On the space side, we have oversight of that. And then I also have oversight on the Armed Services Committee side of all of our spy satellite programs and the development of the newest branch of the military, the Space Force. And so I just want to talk to you about both of those very briefly and then hand it over to Tyler. And I've got a couple of touch points that we just figured out in the reception before this that we've had. On the NASA side, well, look, on all of it, both sides, this is such an exciting time. On the NASA side, we're talking about the future of the International Space Station. How do we commercialize that? Basically, with microgravity and the research that's ongoing, that is groundbreaking stuff that companies want to be able to do, that are willing to pay to be able to do, and everything from macular degeneration to the most advanced materials, that things that we haven't even fully discovered yet that can be developed and researched up in space is starting to happen with the intersection of this public-private partnership that's really, I would say, really only come together in the last 4 to 5 years of NASA and its traditional role and these new space companies, what some people like to call kind of old space and new space. I don't really love that moniker because I think both sides have a really important role. But the development of the space station, the march to put the next person on the moon, which is part of the Artemis program, that will have the first American woman on the moon, the first American of color on the moon, and it's a race, folks. But to get the next American period on the moon before some of our competitors, which I'll talk about in a moment. But, one of the big differences from 50 years ago to today, and it was just in 2019, we celebrated the 50th anniversary of Apollo. But the big difference is we're no longer alone in space. We have competition up there. The Indians have a very aggressive space program. The Chinese are launching more into space now than the rest of the world combined, including the United States. The Israelis came this close to putting an unmanned lander on the moon. It crashed at the last second, but they're determined to go again. And look, it's not even just the moon, it's Mars too. The UAE has launched an orbiter to Mars. This is full on and full blown. And I have a saying now that we cannot continue to be number one on Earth if we're number two in space. It's a competition, but it's a healthy competition, I think, in every way on the commercial side. At the same time, we're also going to really exciting things like what we're seeing with the Starlink program, say, from SpaceX. We just saw with the tragedy that's happening in Ukraine, where the Russians were deliberately trying to cut the entire country off from the internet. And we saw a private sector American company in SpaceX say, you know what, we're gonna put the internet over this war zone. We're not gonna let this happen. We're not gonna let the Russians do that. That happened in a matter of weeks. Really, truly incredible. On the national security side, it's a little more daunting. I'll just be candid here. Our adversaries, the Russians and the Chinese Communist Party in particular, know that our modern economy, agriculture, banking, real-time logistics, how I got here today on GPS, the same system of how our precision-guided munitions target the bad guys around the world, that we have a massive dependency in our modern economy on what's up in space, and our military's ability to shoot, move, and communicate and keep us safe around the world is also totally dependent on what's up in space. Our adversaries know that, and they have developed offensive weaponry to take those satellites down. To one, to cripple our economy, and to two, to cripple our military. So there's a bit of a space race going on right now to defend the things that we have up there, but to also be able to put theirs at risk. If you remember the theory of mutually assured destruction on nuclear weapons, basically both sides lose, so therefore nobody does anything. That's developing up in space as well. And in the war games that we see, whether it's up in, it's in Ukraine, it's with Russia, it's with the Chinese Communist Party, it's with our adversaries, the first shots are fired in cyberspace and the first shots are fired in space because of those dependencies. I know that sounds a little dark and harsh, but folks, we need to, because we can't see it, doesn't mean it's not happening. And I think we need a little bit of a wake-up call, and that's why make your jokes about Space Force. I get it. It was a funny series on Netflix, but it's deadly serious in terms of having that agency be capable and have it be funded. One more thing that's happening here locally, and then I just want to tell you about how a quick story on how Tyler and I intersected that we just figured out. This area, what I call the Space Triangle between Daytona, Orlando, and Melbourne, of course, with Cape Canaveral sitting in the middle of it, is booming. It's so exciting, the technologies that are happening. For example, I just met with a company called Made in Space that is doing 3D printing in space. One of the big challenges, obviously, is the physics of getting a lot of stuff on top of a rocket in the volumes that we need to, say, put a base on the moon or go to Mars. Well, gosh, isn't it amazing if we can put industrial size 3D printers up there and they make it, both in low Earth orbit and on Mars and heading into deep space. We're on track, and key components of the program are here in the Space Triangle to put a space station around the moon that will then serve as a launching pad, not only for back and forth missions to the moon, but out to Mars, called the Gateway Program. That will be resupplied from here in this area. What do all of these companies need? They need talent. They are desperate for good talent. And who's going to provide that talent for this new, exciting, military competition, not so exciting, scary, But the commercial piece of it, the new economy, Embry-Riddle University. And so Dr. Butler, I'm really thrilled to do anything I can support what you're doing here. And then finally, to Virgin Orbit, I want to just say they have a fascinating program that's really needed. We don't think about it often, but what would happen if, for example, God forbid, knock on wood, a hurricane took down Cape Canaveral and we didn't have that launch facility anymore, or some type of cyber attack, or God forbid, if we got into some type of future shooting war where they know if they take out our satellites, we're going to launch replacements from Cape Canaveral and they cripple that capability. Well, we need some backup plans. And what Virgin Orbit's doing is really exciting. I know Tyler will describe it far better than I will, but in layman's terms, they're launching rockets from underneath a 747. That they get the thing up in orbit, and then they get the thing up to altitude, and then very quickly get it up into space. We need that kind of capability. It's not just a backup. It's a complement to what we're doing in terms of traditional launch. And then finally, one of the most special moments that I had now in Congress was going with the President of the United States to the manned launch, the first manned launch from Cape Canaveral, sending our astronauts to the space station that we did in 2020. From Cape Canaveral with SpaceX that sent Bob and Doug, the two colonels. They were Marines and Air Force, but that's okay. I'm Army, but you know, we'll let that go. But we can't lose sight of the fact that that was the first launch of astronauts from American soil from a private sector company. We hadn't done that since the end of the space shuttle program. We lost our ability for a decade to send American astronauts from American soil into space. Sadly, and I think ironically, we were dependent on the Russians for nearly a decade. Well, that ended with this launch, and to be standing behind the president and the vice president as they watched that rocket go up was incredible. And then to be able to go and visit with Elon Musk, who looked like the weight of the world just lifted off his shoulders, was even more incredible. And never in a million years did consider myself kind of a redneck from the west side of Jacksonville, did I think I would be standing there and experiencing that. And lo and behold, we just figured out Tyler, who's your guest speaker and the president of Virgin Orbit, was in the same room with Elon Musk and the president and the vice president at the same time. We were just comparing photos going, oh my God, you were right there. So really thrilled to have you here. Thanks for coming to Embry-Riddle. It's quite a small world, but you know what? The space community is a small, tight-knit group of just amazing Americans and individuals and kind of space thought leaders all over the world. What I love is that it's American ingenuity, American entrepreneurship, and really the private sector working alongside government to make it happen. And me and my government role are happy to support, enthusiastically will support. And again, thanks for coming. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Congressman Walz. That was really inspiring, and it's great to know that Riddle can play such a role in the future of space commercially and from a defense standpoint. So thank you for that. It's now my pleasure to introduce our student moderator, Ryan Kirby. Ryan is an MBA student of finance and will graduate this summer from the O'Malley College of Business. He received his undergraduate degree in business from Embry-Riddle, specializing in accounting and finance with a cumulative grade point average of 4.0. Quite impressive. Ryan's currently working on a project with Professor Jenna Tinoco, focusing on space debris mitigation for the commercial sector in the lower Earth orbit. Professor Tinoco, thank you for being here tonight. Appreciate that. In addition to his classroom studies, Ryan was a captain on the men's soccer team, where he played during his 4 years as an undergraduate student. He's currently working as an associate at Alderman & Company Investment Bank, a sell-side investment bank specializing in aerospace, aviation and defense companies. He plans to continue with Alderman and Company after he graduates this summer. Please join me in welcoming Ryan Kirby.
Thank you very much, Provost Mueller. So tonight, I have the pleasure to be joined by Mr. Tyler Grinnell. He is an alumnus of Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University, graduating in 2008 with a Bachelor of Science degree in Aerospace Engineering. He has over 15 years of industry experience, spending time at some of the most highly regarded space companies in the world. These companies include the Boeing Company, NASA, SpaceX, and Virgin Orbit. Currently, he is the Vice President for Test Flight and Launch at Virgin Orbit. Mr. Grinnell is going to present the dynamic drop point, then we'll transition into a Q&A, and then we'll open the floor to questions from the audience for Mr. Tyler Grinnell. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Tyler Grinnell.
Thank you, everybody. Congressman Waltz, thank you very much. President Butler, thank you for having me, as well as Provost Mueller. And Ryan, I'm super excited for our question and answer that we're going to have in the near future here. When I was originally approached about coming to Embry-Riddle and speaking, I didn't know what to talk about. And after a little bit of thought, I wanted to, you know, have a conversation with each of the students, leaders, and apply this to everybody's day-to-day life and overall career paths, and then go through how it applies to Virgin Orbit today. And this is where I came up with the dynamic drop point. So starting out, really like to talk through a little bit about me first to give you guys a little bit of history, because not too long ago, I was in many of your shoes. The picture on the bottom left here was my first internship with the Boeing Company, and that was a dream come true for me to be able to work on the space shuttle program while I was just out of my sophomore year at Embry-Riddle. So I like to follow up with that is that was my first dream. Meanwhile, when I was a younger kid, I wanted to be an astronaut. My goal was to somehow get into space. And I didn't know exactly what that meant, being from upstate New York, and realized that the space industry was pretty small at the time. And in order to work in the space industry, NASA was the place to be. So I started Googling different universities that were close to NASA facilities, and Embry-Riddle popped up immediately. And I decided Embry-Riddle was the place for me, and came to Embry-Riddle, had many fun conversations with my dad about traveling from New York to Florida and locating my life in Florida. From that point, I got to the university and didn't really know many people. So I was trying to figure out, find friends, figure out which parts of Florida that I liked, and I saw a group of guys that were playing flag football. And lo and behold, it was some members of the Sigma Chi fraternity. So I became a member of the Sigma Chi fraternity, and many of those friends that I had on day one that I was here on campus are my best friends today. So that really kick-started my time at Embry-Riddle. And then it was figuring out, how can I get to NASA? So what's the fastest way that I could get there? And I had zero work experience. So somehow, as a freshman, I ended up working in the manufacturing lab, actually printing out and CNC routing senior design projects for some of the students that were designing airplanes and creating their models. After about a year of that, I applied for an internship opportunity at Kennedy Space Center. I probably applied to 100 different opportunities around the world, and just wanted to be in the space industry, did not care what it was. The one that I really wanted was to end up at Kennedy Space Center, and there was only one opportunity available with the Boeing company. So I ended up receiving the position, and the hiring manager let me know the reason behind that. And it was because I was the only candidate that wrote a cover letter and talked about my passion of space. So this conversation today is going to be a lot about being different and setting yourself apart from everybody else. So while I was at the Boeing company, I found out that if I actually worked full-time, they would help pay for schooling for me. So I talked to my hiring manager, asked if we could extend my internship so I could work full-time while going to school. So for the next year, I took around 15 to 17 credit hours and worked full-time at Kennedy Space Center. So I would get up around 3 a.m., be at work at about 4:15, 4:30, work until about 11 a.m., hightail it back to Embry-Riddle, and then begin my class day. And that went through about 7 p.m. And then it was time to do homework and study, and then rinse and repeat and do it over again. I would not recommend that for everybody. It was pretty tough. but from then, there was an opportunity that came up with NASA, and I did the same thing. I received an opportunity to work on fluid systems on the Constellation program, which was the replacement for the space shuttle. So I was working environmental control systems and some high pressure helium systems for the ground systems design. And during that time period, I wanted to get to know the NASA leadership quite a bit. So the engineering director at Kennedy Space Center and I would talk often about different methodologies on how we were approaching the problems at hand with our ground systems, how we were solving them, and really seeing what the future was about. And he was acting as a really good mentor for me. And then it came time to graduate from Embry-Riddle, and I was at my dream job. I came down from upstate New York, was able to work on the space shuttle program with Boeing, and I was asking myself, what's next? And somebody let me know there was this new company called SpaceX. I was at an outside event here at Embry-Riddle. One of my friends let me know he had an interview with this guy named Elon Musk. And I didn't know who he was, had no idea what SpaceX was, and went home, Googled everything, and about a month later, I had an interview with Elon and ended up getting a job with SpaceX. And there were many conversations with my family members about why in the world would I go from NASA and go to this company that is just starting up in the space industry. And some parts of life are about taking risks and achieving different milestones throughout your career. So while I was at SpaceX, I was able to work on many items where my education at Embry-Riddle was a direct reflection about what I could actually work on. So I started out with fluid systems design on liquid oxygen systems, went over to perform low voltage ground systems design, was an avionics responsible engineer for the Falcon 9 rocket, became the first vehicle controller to basically launch a vehicle and Falcon 9 rocket into space. And then I really got interested in leadership and people. So during that time period, there was an opportunity to take on a leadership role of the ground systems team. So I raised my hand really quickly, jumped in to go do that. And from that point on, my career really shifted from really loving the technical work and being an individual contributor to focusing on the people. And through that time, I was able to work on an amazing team that was returning boosters, putting men and women into space since the space shuttle, and really privatizing that. So then 2020 comes along, and we just recently put Bob and Doug into space. And I asked myself kind of what's next. And it was like, okay, let's take a break. So I took about a 6-month break to figure out like what was next. And did I want to do anything next? Did I want to sit on the beach? Did I want to change career paths? And really figuring out what avenue to go down. And an opportunity came up with Virgin Orbit, which they just got to orbit for the first time in January of last year. And basically came in to help scale the company and go from an aspirational company to operational. So right now, we've been able to get to orbit successfully 3 times. The launch platform can launch essentially from anywhere. And it's full of a very diverse team. So going over about these pictures a little bit more and why they're up here, and how it correlates back to the dynamic drop point. While I was growing up, I said I was never getting married. My wife and I started dating, and we agreed. We were just happy as can be together. Then I proposed. So check, got married, something I said I was never going to do. And before we started dating, we talked about children and whether we were going to have kids or not. And I was very focused on my career. And we decided, okay, we're good to go. We'll figure out kids later. Let's put that on the back burner. On St. Patrick's Day of this year, Beckham was born. So really proved myself wrong again. Check. And then never in my lifetime did I think you would be able to land boosters back simultaneously from a launch pad. And in most textbooks, it said it was impossible. So again, another check on something that seemed like was never going to happen. And then up until this past year and a half, didn't really put a lot of thought into airplanes and rockets, and really personally never thought that I would be able to work on airplanes, that I'd stay in the rocket industry. So now with Virgin Orbit, we've got a launch platform that utilizes a 747 and can launch rockets and payloads into space. So another thing that was not on my career path originally, or path in life. So going into it on an overview of Virgin Orbit, essentially it was founded in 2017 under the high-level vision of space for everyone from everywhere. And that hits home a lot because when you associate most launch companies, they're ground-based. So payloads need to come to the launch provider, and all of the integration happens at the facility close to the ground launch pad, and then you launch from the launch pad. This whole model was changed with Virgin Orbit and the Queen of the Sky, the 747. So this air launch capability is able to utilize a 747. We're able to utilize the wing of an aircraft. We can mate a rocket that's ready to launch on the wing of the aircraft, mate the payload, fuel it, take off, and then launch. This is mind-blowing in how launch capability has always been done, and I would say even taught. So another key point is stay dynamic, change will happen. Think outside of the box. The other part that I'm very fortunate of is with a previous position, I was able to be a part of launching humans into space. So I already understood what it took to go do that, but it's really amazing to hear that the launch platform utilizes 2 pilots and 2 launch engineers to autonomously launch a rocket into space. And that's something that it's really hard to get your head wrapped around, that any decision that you make and any failure, there's humans involved. And you've got to make sure everything is perfect. So we're going to talk through and show you what the last launch was, which was called Above the Clouds.
The morning of is an interesting thing. We're very excited, there's a lot of anticipation. There's a big element of trust in the lines from the people who go for Rocky. It's not uncharted territory anymore. We know what we're doing, we've done this before, we're getting confident. Feel good. Your imagination kind of stops. You go into muscle.
Good morning. Are
you on track today? I'm on track. I got the upbeat crew chiefs. They're in the racetrack. Clouds are from 30,000 feet up to 34,000 feet all through the racetrack. It's a solid cloud bed.
You know, as I'm doing this right thing, I look out my window and I see this bright blue with this rocket, you know, shooting in space. It's pretty awesome.
Looks like we made a lovely cloud in order to orbit.
What's fantastic today is to show the capability to go from behind it through that weather, get the rocket somewhere at night to be able to launch it, which will then show the capability as the aerobics go. Great.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So getting into the details about this flight path is we essentially have our main spaceport out of Mojave Air and Space Center. The Cosmic Girl and Launcher One platform can essentially launch from anywhere that has a runway to be able to take off and land a 747. Payload customers have always wanted to have the launch platform come to them. We're able to bring that ability and capability to each of the customers out there, whether it's the government, different countries, or essentially private industry. So the sequence of events of this, I think we went through it pretty well in this last video, but I'd like to talk through it a little bit. We initially take off from the spaceport. Cosmic Girl actually goes through, which is our 747, a flight path called the racetrack, where we are at altitude, and the plane actually goes through the conditions that we're going to see at the time of the drop. And then once we get through that, understand the conditions, pilot understands how the plane is flying, we then do a hot pass and get to the point where there's a pull-up maneuver performed, just under Mach 1 at about 35,000 feet, and then we drop the rocket, and the plane banks to the right, and then our payload customers are on their way to orbit. So a differentiator for Virgin Orbit and the Launcher One platform is overall capability. ground launch providers have many weather constraints that you don't have at 35,000 feet. There are many range assets that are needed for ground launch where I think folks have listened in on launches and heard of a boat in the box and launches are scrubbed. That is something that is pretty foreign to this air launch capability. And then also being mobile. Virgin Orbit is going to be launching from the United Kingdom this summer. And this is done by utilizing a ground system that's been built and designed from the ground up to be transportable, fit inside of a 747, and bring the end-to-end launch site to the given spaceport. During the G7 summit, Virgin Orbit had a Launcher One rocket on display. And Boris Johnson stopped by and actually sat with the team and talked about the impact of this launch capability for about 45 minutes with the Virgin Orbit community. The other aspect of this is we've been grounded for over 60 years with launch capability. And this air launch system has many benefits compared to ground launch. And it's something that is very hard to teach. It's all about being dynamic and thinking outside of the box on how you can innovate and change how things are done. So how does the dynamic drop point really, you know, apply to each of you? So your life and career is yours to make. Nobody else can decide that for you. A couple things that I live by is be forward stepping, ask for forgiveness instead of permission. And a lot of decisions, there's usually a lot of gray area. And if permission is always the stance, the innovation kind of stops. Also, change is hard. Being unfazed by change in strategic development is something that will impact everybody's day-to-day life and careers. My day-to-day changes as soon as I wake up. I'll have a plan in the morning, and 15 minutes later, the whole day has changed. Luckily today, I was kept on schedule. It was great. And then your dreams of today will become your story of tomorrow. And I say this because every time that I think I've reached my dream, something else comes across, and it's even better. And it's nothing that has even been on my radar. So be extremely resilient to change. And Ryan, I think that's everything. We can get into the Q&A.
Well done. Thank you very much. So just the way this is going to work, I have a couple of questions about the material that you presented naturally, and then I'm going to rotate through questions focused on industry, careers, and the university, just to get the most out of the time that we have with you. So firstly, you showed us how Virgin Orbit were able to be successful despite weather conditions and a whole host of different things that may affect a launch. And what sort of margin of error that do you have whilst you're launching a satellite from a 747 in the way that you do?
So really, rocketry is pretty unforgivable. And luckily, 747s have been around for quite some time in planes in general. So the precision that we can hit a specific latitude and longitude and altitude and parameters to have the ability to drop the rocket at the right location and have it ignite and go to orbit is extremely well known. So that part definitely has challenges, but luckily, the aviation industry has solved those for us. And we're really utilizing those lessons learned and the technical knowledge into the overall platform that we have.
And based on Virgin Orbit's launch this summer from Spaceport Cornwall, are you just, I'm trying to gauge, are you really aware of the impact that you have on local economies from building such a mobile launch system?
So I did not really appreciate the impact that it would have up until about 5 to 6 months ago. And since then, it's made me fall back to, you know, what has inspired me to be where I'm at today and have that same process available for students in the UK. So Virgin Orbit as a whole, as we get over to the UK, is actually looking at making sure that we have community outreach. And we're taking the time to have folks have the ability to see the launch system and platform, which I'm really looking forward to, and then also showcasing the launch availability in the UK.
Yeah, and it even spans to areas of the US and places that have previously never even been considered a possibility, which I think is just truly amazing. Now we're kind of transitioning over to a real kind of flip here. Currently, there are no real kind of enforced space laws. We have the Space Treaty and we have the UN guidelines, which historically haven't seemed to hold any real enforcement behind them. How do you operate and lead in an industry that has no commonly understood or agreed upon laws?
So I think you have to lead by example. The launch platform in general for Launcher One is not on a wildlife refuge. It does not have the sound pollution that you normally have. And I say this because satellites are going to continue going into orbit. And the number of them is going to continue to increase. And as a society, we really need to focus on collision avoidance of those satellites and be the tip of the spear at these regulations on what actually needs to be put in place to ensure we're looking out for ourselves. So I would say we're doing our best to lead by example. And from a regulatory standpoint, I would say if something doesn't make sense, we work extremely hard to get those changed. But we also work pretty hard to introduce regulations that need to be in place for everybody.
Right. And you've worked for several different and widely recognized companies. What is one skill that has translated into a single role that you've taken on? And that kind of translates from technical roles that you've had now to maybe more so leadership roles.
It's really about the team. So many great individual technical oriented folks can put together a product in an okay manner alone. But when you get the team working together, the solutions that they come up with really surprise you. So what I like to do is make sure that we're very team focused, and instead of bringing up barriers, we're opening doors for teammates to be either moving around within the company, working with their peers, and really stressing the high points of teamwork.
During your presentation and conversing with you as well, we've learned that you worked at the Boeing Company and NASA for periods while studying during your undergraduate degree, and someone who's been working while studying. I'm really curious to know that you've done 9 internships during your time at Embry-Riddle. And how did you manage to get that work-life harmony? Not the work-life balance, as you say. How did you manage to achieve that during those years or not?
So I would say that I focus on the work-life harmony now because I did not focus on it before. And I knew what it was doing to myself by putting that amount of work on myself and my friends. And up until, I would say, 6 to 8 years ago, I did not fully appreciate the total impact of being career-focused versus being full end-to-end work-life harmony-focused. And that's something that I think makes A, well-rounded people, and B, awesome employees. There were times throughout my career that I did not have a great work-life harmony, and it reflected on my personal life. So this is something that I would tell myself at the beginning of my career to have a work-life harmony. And I don't think I would actually go through and do 9 internships and work full-time while going to school. I don't know what that impact would have been on my career, but I do know what impact that has had on my personal life. And it's something that I would probably go back and change a little bit.
You were heavily involved in Falcon 9 launch, carrying the Dragon capsule to the space station. And I understand you were the first vehicle controller for the Falcon 9. Could you just expand on this this work for us? And I know SpaceX is one of the booming commercial space companies that everyone's kind of drawn towards these days.
So in the moment, I would say I never really thought about the impact of what was going on. There was a job that needed to be done, and I was in a role trained to go do that job. And as a company, we succeeded. And it was a team effort. And looking back on it, it's pretty surreal. And I don't think I could summarize it in any different way.
And kind of the flip side of that with the increase in commercial space, which is great, but the commercial boom of the past 5 to 8 years, does the number of these satellite constellations and the sheer number and volume of satellites going up specifically into low Earth orbit, does that concern you? Does that keep you up at night? How does that play out in your mind?
So I look at the amount of constellations as a very good thing. Space does run our day-to-day, and it's the side of the regulations that we really have to look into and make sure that we are having that right collision avoidance in space. And be a little bit more forward thinking. I think in overall space, we've been a little reactionary as a species, and we've got the opportunity to be proactive before I would say space is too full. And at this time, it's really not super compact. As everybody drives down the road each day, you've got cars within feet of you. Space is nowhere near that. And the control that you can have with a spacecraft is much better than the control that you and I can do while we're driving. So I think focusing on the attitude control and actual like positioning of satellites is key.
Yeah. As already mentioned, Virgin Orbit recently announced they're aiming to launch from Spaceport Cornwall this summer. Space is an international industry. What are some of the benefits of working with teams from around the world? What have you learned from that?
So it's actually fundamentally from Embry-Riddle is diversity is key to everything. So when you get a group of people that have the same ideas together, you usually come up with a pretty vanilla answer. But when you get a diverse set of people around the world with different backgrounds and different thought processes, you just get this solution that nobody ever thought that they would create. So the unknown, but knowing that the solution is going to be amazing is something that I really enjoy about the diversity and getting different diverse backgrounds together.
Yeah, definitely. During your time at Embry-Riddle, was there an experience, organization, or club, you've mentioned Sigma Chi fraternity, that you remember opened doors for you when transitioning into the working world?
I'll go back to Sigma Chi fraternity. Utilization of alumni across the board is something that I would highly recommend to everybody. And Sigma Chi provided a platform to not only get to know very successful alumni face-to-face, but job opportunities come up with those connections. And with most roles and positions in life, if you know somebody, you'll at least get an interview a majority of the time. But almost getting that opening is a very hard thing to go do. So anytime that you can open up an opportunity to rise above, I would say take that chance. So something that I've learned today as I've been touring the campus is how many clubs and organizations that are here. I think there's over 200. And the facilities that the students and faculty can utilize here is pretty astounding. So I would say take on an extracurricular activity and utilize that alumni base because they're willing to help.
Yeah. And for, not sure who's in the audience today, but if you were to be able to look out and speak to a freshman or a sophomore or one of those people who've just joined the university, if you could pick one thing to make sure that they do in the next year or two, in those first times of being at the school, what is something that you would say to them directly?
Do not give up on your dream today. There are a lot of challenges going to school. There's some courses that you will take, and you're not going to do well in them. There may be some folks that can skate through school, but there will be times and trials and tribulations that you have to work through. So don't be demotivated. Actually utilize those hard points as motivation, and that will allow you to work through problems in a different manner once you get through there. And you'll end up better on the other end, I promise.
Now, this school has naturally a very heavy aviation focus. And we've seen that the FAA supported net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2015. We see this kind of adapted by the aviation industry as a whole. How do you envision the space industry transitioning to more sustainable methods of launch or just in general in terms of operation?
So I think looking forward at Earth and making sure it's preserved for ourselves and for all of humanity, you really look at all of the pollutants, and there are rocket technologies that utilize essentially water exhaust that have almost zero impact. And then there are also areas and methodologies like Virgin Orbit. We can utilize and have the ability to launch over water, not on a wildlife refuge, and really get customers to where they want to go. So it is all about being a bit forward thinking and seeing how you can minimize your overall impact on Earth today and making it better for the future. So that's definitely a heavy focus that I think we could be also doing a little bit better on as an end-to-end society. But also opening up space is a stepping stone to making our lives easier and also looking at how we are impacting Earth. So I think the means of transportation to get to orbit in the short term may be counterbalanced by what we will learn from getting to orbit. And then the next step is how do you reduce those overall emissions?
And kind of leading on from that, what are some of the key areas that the space industry has learned from the aviation industry, whether that's in terms of leadership, ways in which you can lead, whether that's in terms of technical launch capabilities? I mean, 747 being a launching capacity is very linked, but is there anything else that really comes to mind?
There's many things. So space is usually looked at as being extremely complex and difficult, and it's got to be quote unquote space rated. However, if you look at designs of rockets, you can use composites. Composites have been around for many decades. And our launch vehicle actually uses a lot of composites. So we've utilized lessons learned from other industries and applied it to the design of the vehicle. Manufacturing and machining, it's applicable everywhere. It's not just a space thing. Space is an application, but many industries have already revolutionized manufacturing processes. So this is a place where we don't have to reinvent the wheel.
Now, considering the nature of the space industry and the style of cross-functional project-based teams used in the industry and projects, how have you been successful through working in these dynamic teams made up of a whole host of different kind of sectors and industries?
So really, it gets down to communication. There's usually an assumption that somebody makes that may be irrelevant, or I think this other individual may have this task. And instead of being direct, folks make these assumptions. So what I like to do is force the whys and the questions amongst the team. And that really, you know, A, allows different people to learn different parts of a project that they normally would not work on. And then B, they get to know how to live in somebody else's shoes, which is something that's really hard to do and understand, like trials and tribulations that somebody may have in a different department that is not affected by, that you're not affected by in your department. So when you get that cross-department communication going, you're not only fixing the problem that you're trying to solve at that time, you're actually overhauling your business. So it's something that I think is imperative across the board.
Now, what do you see as the biggest obstacle for space launch operations and flight in the next year and then possibly in the next 10 years? So short term and then long term. And I know longer term is a bit harder because of the innovative nature of the industry, but kind of looking at it short term and long term, what are those big obstacles that you foresee?
I think in the short term, if you look at the capability of overall satellites and the size and the technology that's evolved, having enough providers to actually be able to put those satellites into orbit, I think, is going to be pretty tough over the next year. In the next 10 years, I think there's going to be a lot of conversations around regulations and how we handle spaceflight. Normally, we're in a position where there's not enough launches to have the reliability statistics where you want them to potentially fly over land. And as rocketry becomes easier, I think you're going to see that change over hopefully within the next decade. But that's only going to come with quote unquote time on the water with launch rate.
Now, kind of switching it and something a little bit more fun, I like to say. And what is something that you look forward to every day in your new role as Vice President for Test Flight and Launch at Virgin Orbit?
It's really whose day I can help make better. There's one individual that's on our team at Virgin Orbit. He's a technician, and he's going to school right now to be an engineer. And sitting down and talking with him about what he's going through while working full-time and going to school and sharing with him things that I've been through has been extremely fun. And then also encouraging him and letting him know that having this hands-on experience and applying that with the technical background that he's getting right now is probably going to make him one of the best contributors in the industry. So each day I try to go around and impact at least one person's day in a positive way.
And you mentioned how you took time off for 6 months. And have you ever really had that I've made it feeling? And another way to kind of ask this is like, have you achieved your measure of success?
So I will say today is pretty surreal. And each day, it's understanding what you really value out of life. So there's been many times throughout my career where I've thought I've quote unquote made it, but they were just milestones. And for me now, it's really kind of an overall impact that I can have in a positive way in the space industry and people's lives. So it definitely varies. There's been many times throughout my career though that it's been pretty fun.
Yeah. And kind of many students benefit from the guidance and expert knowledge of a mentor throughout their early stages of their career, but then also throughout the rest of their career as well. Is this something that you utilized? And if so, could you please kind of expand upon that?
Yes. Yeah, so while I was at SpaceX, one of the hiring director of the launch site became a really great mentor of mine. He's also an Embry-Riddle alumni, Brian Mosdell. And he actually went through and had many lessons learned from me from his career. And him and I still talk quite often. And he was actually my best man at my wedding. So it's really weird as you go through life, there's people that you will meet that you don't know what kind of impact they will have on you. And you don't know what kind of impact you will have on other people. So really keep an open mind because changes happen pretty quickly.
That's incredible. And how would you go about finding someone who would mentor you? Would you find that in the workplace? Would you find that at school? How would a student go about doing that?
So in my life, I always looked at the person that I wanted to either be in their position or talk to them about how they got to their portion of their career. And I would go talk with them immediately. So while I was at NASA, I became great friends with the head of engineering. At SpaceX, I had many conversations with Brian. At Virgin Orbit, I speak with our COO, Tony Genghis, as well as Dan Hart, our president, just to talk through things that are happening outside of life or outside of work, things that are happening at work, and you know, working to trailblaze how we operate as a company. So it's very dynamic.
And as a general question for people in the room who are about to graduate or who are starting their time at Embry-Riddle right now, what is a general piece of advice that you would have for someone who were to work and enter the space industry and really want to excel in that industry specifically?
So a lesson learned from the start of my career was I was very focused on what I was contributing to a specific project. And I would encourage you, when you take on your first role or task, think of the larger picture and impact. And there may be somebody that's working on part of the project that's struggling where you can help out. There may be a place where you're struggling and you're afraid to ask for help. I would encourage you to go ask for that help and to over-communicate and think about the larger entity instead of the individual portion of the project that you're working on.
Now, if you were the king for the day, or you were the, you could say anything that you wanted and it would become true. What is a specific satellite service that is not offered currently that you would like to see offered in the future?
That is a tough question. I actually think from a communication standpoint, you're seeing it right now. I love boating. I also love being 20 miles offshore and not having a cellular network next to me. But I do think having that agility to have wireless connectivity throughout the world at all times is a really good advantage that we can utilize as humans. So I think we're seeing that happen today. And it's really going to change our day-to-day interaction very soon. So this is another place where I don't think we've actually realized the use capability. And it's really fun to think through how life will be when you do have constant connectivity and what you can optimize on your day-to-day or projects that you're working.
So naturally what comes after that is, so what's next for Virgin Orbit?
So really, Virgin Orbit is in the phase where we're scaling, we're increasing our production rate, we're increasing our launch rate, we're going to be the first, I would say, company and entity to launch from the UK. So I really think looking at how Virgin Orbit can be agile and adapt to these new situations that are coming up. 15 years ago, the small satellite industry was orders of magnitude different from where it is today. And many of these small satellite companies and customers are ride shares on these larger rockets. So being able to put them into an orbit that they desire and a location that they want as the primary satellite on a rocket is something that I think we're just starting to see happen in industry. And I'm pretty excited to see where that goes.
And then on a more personal note, so what's next for you in your career? What's next for you in terms of what do you want to achieve next? What's the next goal?
So I am going to answer this like I have my whole career. I have no idea what I want to be when I grow up.
Yeah, I get that. That's great. And that's a great philosophy to go by, and it's certainly done you well so far. Now, what is something that you learned during your time at college that you've kept with you throughout your career? And that can be personal, that can be technical, that can be whatever it may be.
Ask for help. So I stopped by career services today. Saw a couple familiar faces that actually helped me kickstart where I am today. And if I never took that initial step, I don't think I would be anywhere near where I'm at today. My career would have most likely taken a very different path. So if there's a question that you do have, go find the person that's got the answer and A, get their advice. B, let them know that if you're having a problem, ask for solutions and follow through. So try not to solve problems alone. They're usually pretty hard to solve by yourself.
Now, just so the audience is aware, we're going to open questions up and we welcome you to just queue up or line up at either of the microphones. And you can do that in this next portion of the Q&A, but I'll continue whilst we are waiting. I will ask a question, then I'll turn it over to you, sir. If you could add anything to the Embry-Riddle school curriculum based on what you had in your time at the school, what would you add in terms of something that you think would be important to learn?
So I actually think the leadership team here is doing a great job at being forward thinking on what industry needs. Something that was a core part of my career was developing control systems and operations and mission controls and launch control systems. And that's something that simply wasn't taught before. And here at Embry-Riddle, it's actually happening now. That was something that I scratched my head at when we first started creating a launch capability. On how to go do it. There wasn't really a book. There were a lot of images of flight control at NASA. There was how launch control has been done at Kennedy Space Center, but there really wasn't an overall end-to-end architecture on how to go do it. So real time, we had to figure that out. And now that there's courses provided, information is there for the students now, which is super helpful and makes them ready to step in immediately upon graduation.
I'll turn it over to yourself.
Have you read the book Endurance by Scott Kelly? the astronaut?
I have not.
It was interesting because he's in space. They call him. He says, "We forgot to tell you about this space debris. Hunker down." And he said, "Well, if it hits me 17,500 each way, that's about 35,000 miles an hour, I won't feel a thing." So about space debris, collision avoidance, sort of two questions is, how do we do this in a way that we avoid collisions when you launch through the thousands of satellites that are there and are planned to put in space without also giving away to the enemy where all our assets are? How do you balance that? Is there a way to have it both ways?
So I will say having a launch platform that's pretty agile helps out with what orbit you're going to and when. So I think we're working through that one as a Virgin Orbit entity right now. But as far as overall collision avoidance and how launches are impacted by that, satellites are actually spread apart pretty far. And the regulations and kind of calculations that we utilize for collision avoidance maneuvers right now are pretty conservative. And the ability for a satellite to get to a specific orbit and insertion is quite high right now, the accuracy. So I think we can utilize the data and let the data tell us where we're going and then refine our regulations and our calculations on how we actually perform collision avoidance with respect to launches.
Mr. Grinnell, Orion, thanks again for stopping by. My name is Alex. I'm aerospace safety senior here. I have two brief questions, but before that, I want you to do a quick remark during your presentation. You made a quote that I really liked. That you said that Virgin Orbit transitioned from being aspirational to operational. I think that's a quote that is going to stick with me for a long time. My first question is, why Cosmic Girl is specifically a 747? And the second question may apply to also other students that are here in the room, and I think I'm asking the right person. Is Virgin Orbit currently offering any internships?
So on the first question, kind of why the 747 and Cosmic Girl, we actually were able to get Cosmic Girl from Virgin Atlantic, and the airplane's name was Cosmic Girl while at Virgin Atlantic. And the reason for a 747 is the lift capability and the overall fit and form that we needed from an air launch perspective. And also, the 747 is the queen of the sky. So it really fit the bill for what we were looking for. And then the name Cosmic Girl was really a cherry on top for us.
And internships by any chance?
So the internships is heck yes. We are hiring across the board. So full-time internships with many different backgrounds.
Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Hi, how's it going? I'm Johan. I had a question. I know earlier in your presentation you were talking about like kind of like the 747 capabilities and launch. Like, what's the cost effective in terms of like usage and price from like a ground takeoff versus using the 747?
So think about the 747 air launch capability in the sense that once you actually drop the rocket for launch and it's on its way into orbit, the engines aren't hitting your launch pad. So from a cost perspective, there's not any refurbishment for our first stage. We literally can land the 747, mate another rocket, and get on with another mission. So from a cost savings perspective, you really eliminate something that's inherent to ground launch, which is the pad turnaround time. So that's a huge beneficial portion of the air launch capability.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, how's it going? I want to preface the question by you don't have to bad talk or kind of rub elbows with any of the companies you've worked with before, but from the engineering perspective of SpaceX and Virgin Orbit, what are the key differences that you've seen between the communication between the engineers and the people side? So how are those interactions between handling people and engineering different at Virgin Orbit compared to SpaceX?
So I would say, I'll make it a little bit more broad as Virgin Orbit in comparison to my past. What I really love about Virgin Orbit is the company culture. There's a very heavy focus on work-life harmony and the people. And that is one of the fundamental items for being a Virgin company. And I'll talk through one instance that happened last year when Sir Richard Branson came out to our Mojave test site. Is we were bringing him around the test site, and we had an engine on the stand. He was really intrigued by the technology and all excited about what we were doing, but looked above, and it was about 115 degrees out, and asked where the shade was and how our employees work out in that hot, humid desert all day. And being concerned about the people is paramount at any Virgin company and Virgin Orbit. So that's something that really resonates with me. And it's something that I go into work every day and make sure that we are ensuring and pushing the limit on overall work-life harmony.
Thank you.
And just to build on, I didn't catch his name. It was a good question. And just to build on that, and I was going to ask about culture, and you've kind of answered it there with your answer, how's the comparison between companies in terms of how have you managed to stay adaptable? How have you managed to adapt to different work cultures? How have you managed to adapt to different positions? And how have you managed to be successful in those? Because you've been in engineering, you've been in leadership positions now, and you've been in some of the biggest space companies, and I'm sure they differ in culture, but you've managed to be successful in all those different scenarios.
So I think it's fundamentally learning the culture and understanding what the daily rhythm is like. And then there are parts of cultures that you won't always like, but there are parts of the culture that you'll love. And what I really love about leadership and even in the individual contributor side is if there's a culture that you don't particularly like, you can help change it by how you interact with your peers, how you interact with your leadership. And the leadership also has a direct reflection on the overall company culture. So I think it's really looking at what environment do you want to be in, and then how can I emulate that? And usually that's what drives a culture, is the people. So I hope that answered the question, but really understanding the company, knowing what you want out of culture, and then making and emulating those changes that you would like to see.
Can I ask a question? I'm just curious. You talk about scaling that. I assume that's in the number of launches and that, but what about the size of the unit? Are there constraints on like ground clearance or length of the rocket or weight? Because it seems like a 747 can carry more weight, but is it, what constrains your next, or will you make it larger? And if so, what's the constraint on it?
So I will say that, really, the constraint right now with our current capability is the ground clearance. We can extend the vehicle. There's also different methodologies on how you can have larger rockets be placed on aircraft in different ways. But what we're really looking at is, you know, the small satellite market with our current launch platform is meeting the needs that our customers are looking for. And then as that industry does change, obviously launch capabilities and type of launches do change along with that. So right now we're really focused on the current customer base, but definitely will respond accordingly to the overall need of the industry.
Can you do it like it's do the space shuttle and put it on top? And
so I like to say from a physics standpoint, yeah, that's been accomplished. But really, we're focusing right now on the current overall architecture that we have with the pylon design on the wing. But I really do like to go back to physics and say from a physics standpoint, it is super capable.
Now, kind of skirting back to one of the first questions that were asked there, how significant do you believe the threat of growing space debris is in low Earth orbit, in LEO and GEO, particularly on launch and then in orbit satellites? And
so for low Earth orbit launches, satellites have kind of a life cycle that they go through if they don't have an onboard propulsion system to maintain their attitude control. So inevitably, satellites will deorbit by themselves in low Earth orbit. But as we do build up these constellations, I think there is a little bit of room for growth how we're operating today and not have major impacts. But this is where space is not going to be getting smaller. We're going to be putting more items in space. And this is, again, where I think we need to look at regulations and then lead by example throughout private and government entities.
And just to give everyone a fair opportunity, I'm going to ask a couple more questions and then we're going to conclude. So just to lead on from that, how do you believe that the space industry can tackle that problem or incentivize commercial companies or other than leading from example, are there any things that come to mind in terms of how can that be addressed?
So, I mean, I think it's really taking a step back and saying, what are we trying to accomplish? Getting the industry leaders together and actually talking through that as a workforce and not trying to solve these problems as standalone companies. So there are conversations going on with many private companies on how we can work through this. There's many working groups that are occurring in the government today. And it's something that I don't think we have the right answer on right now, but the key players are working through this to talk on how we can solve it.
I'm short. So what is the difference of cost from an air launch and from a ground launch? Like, do you save more fuel from an air launch or is it basically the same?
So it actually depends on the size of the rocket as a whole and what your cost per kilogram is essentially to orbit. You do have a cost savings by not needing to refurbish a launch pad with air launch. At the same time, you're utilizing a 747 that has been used for much time. And then the ground launch capability, you do have a launch pad that you can reuse, but you do have, I would say, that refurbishment time. And then as you scale and ramp up and increase your launch cadence, that's where you really get economies of scale. So the more that companies do launch and utilize their specific capability, the cost gets cheaper. So short answer is it depends on the model that you're working with. It can be either ground or air launch, depending on where your specific events are that day.
Thank you.
Thank you, Noah.
Now, I like to think that at this school where we're generating the next generation of leaders. Now, whether that's in sport, whether that's in aviation, aerospace, space, whatever it may be, I think that we're generating the next generation of leaders. What would you say to it coming from someone who was very technical, then transitioned to that leadership side? What is a piece of advice on how to lead? how to lead a workforce. When you're responsible for other people, you're responsible for other people's livelihoods, other people's work day to day. What is one thing that you would say to this next generation?
Understand you are not the leader. You work for each of the employees and folks that are within your organization and company as a whole. So you are in a leadership authority position, but follow your employees. And when you can make their lives easier in their day-to-day, really good things happen as far as their overall happiness and the throughput that they can get done at work each day. So understanding that you work for your employees.
Servant leadership kind of, yeah. And then one of the closing remarks here, I heard you say a few times today, and I thought it would be really nice if you kind of expanded upon this, is that when asked about who do you think your biggest competitor is in the industry, or who do you think is a main competitor of Virgin Orbit, you reply in a very unique, in a almost agreed upon in the industry way. I've been very lucky to have a lot of experiences this year, going to conferences and things of that nature. And people often reply in the way that you say. So I would just welcome you to expand upon what you usually say. And I think that would be a great insight for a lot of people.
So listen, private industry is really taking off right now. Only in the past 15 years have you seen industry go from launching from government entities to the private sector. I do not look at this as competition. I look at this as we need to have a capability across the world to be able to put humans and satellites into space. So to me, folks may look at this as a competition as far as the day-to-day tactical, but longer term, we need everybody to be successful. So there's really not a us versus them or competition. It's a, how can we all complement one another and really revolutionize space travel as a whole?
And that's an atmosphere I'd never experienced before. I've been to a lot of different things and it's never of its competitors, but in this industry, it's very much different. I would open the floor up for yourself to have any closing remarks, anything you'd like to say to students in particular, or anything you would like to say about your experience back on campus here at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University.
I would like to thank everybody for the amazing 24 hours. The campus has changed dramatically since I've been here, since I graduated in 2008, and everything that I wished was on campus in 2008 is here today. So what I would say is take advantage of it, and you know, ask questions. If you have questions about space in general, leadership, classes, I'm not available all of the time, but feel free to reach out and reach out to other industry leaders and individuals and utilize the support staff that's here. You have world-renowned professors and experts and leaders on this campus that you can utilize every day. And don't wait for somebody to approach you. If there's something that you have a question on, if there is something that you would really like to focus on, go find a way to make it happen. That's about it.
That's great.
Yeah.
And last minute question.
Okay, thank you very much. This is a retirement project for me. I'm much more excited to be at school than I was when I was 18. And here at the center of the universe for spacecraft. So I can't tell you how excited I am as to listen to you speak. My view is that I'm doing airplane maintenance for 2 years and then engineering. And I made that decision because engineers have told me that if they had more mechanical background in the design process, it would help them. And mechanics have told me that they sometimes see installations that were perhaps designed by someone who wasn't familiar with mechanical challenges. And so I thought a mechanical background before engineering might be the right step. And the question I have, I think I know your answer, but do you visualize an opportunity for a person who has this two-year FAA mechanics license and then is working on engineering, being able to do internships and so forth with the company, utilizing that skill to not only study the engineering topics, but be a better asset to the company because he brings that to the table as an engineer in training. Normally we think of mechanics being in one job group and engineers being in another group, but I see them definitely overlapped. And I'm sure you'll agree, but I'm asking if that's true. And I could move in that direction as I get towards the end of my mechanic training.
That's a resounding yes. Something that really has bothered me throughout my career is the interaction between the technician workforce and the engineering workforce, and the communication has been lacking there. So something that I encourage and have the team work through is living a day in each other's shoes. So our engineers work in the field next to the technicians, get feedback immediately on design changes that need to happen. Our technicians are also in design reviews. And it's something that we all fulfill different roles, but they are interrelated more than most people realize. So I particularly like to be in the field at least a couple times a month to understand the processes and see how things are actually operating. To make sure that we're getting truth data, and B, seeing how we can refine our processes and how the interaction on the team is going. So our best employees are usually folks that are extremely good with their hands and have the technical backing. So heck yes.
Thank you very much.
And yeah, to conclude on a heck yes, thank you very much to yourself, Mr. Grinnell, for your knowledge, for your time and your willingness to tell your story. And it was certainly a compelling and extremely interesting one. I also wanted to take the time to thank Congressman Colonel Waltz, who came and spoke here at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University. I wanted to thank Dr. Butler, and I wanted to thank Provost Muller for this opportunity that I've been extremely great. I'm extremely grateful to have, and I've really enjoyed everything. And thank you very much to Dean Gibson and Dr. Tanoko of the O'Malley College of Business, who really provided this opportunity as well for me to grasp, and I've certainly enjoyed it. So thank you very much, Mr. Grinnell, and good evening, everyone. Thank you.